Good morning and welcome to All Saints at Home.
Welcome to All Saints.
Welcome, welcome to All Saints Church.
Welcome to All Saints.
Welcome.
Welcome to All Saints.
Welcome to All Saints, Sidmouth.
A very warm welcome to All Saints Church.
Welcome everybody to All Saints Sidmouth online service. Hope you enjoy it.
Oh, hello. Welcome to All Saints. Good morning and welcome to All Saints online. Our church service on Sunday the 1st of November. You're most welcome if you are joining us for the first time or if you are a regular member of All Saints. Today is All Saints Day and we can remember as a family that we are all saints together here in Sidmouth. One person I'd like you to look up is Maximilian Kloeb. He was a priest in Auschwitz during the Second World War and gave his life for an unknown person. To him. It's worth looking up online and just seeing the amazing sacrifice that he gave for a fellow person So please do that and be impressed by him. Let's just pray. Father, we thank you for this day. Thank you for the prayers that you've answered for each one of us this week. And Lord, thank you for the prayers that are ongoing. Lord, as we, Lord, take hold of this service this morning, I pray that, Lord, you would come and be with us and bless us in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, we are going to sing a song together at home. You're going to sing it to yourself or to this screen. And it's Our God is a Great Big God. And it's a good place to start as our service this morning with Peter Scott's preaching to us later is about the unseen and how having faith in God in the unseen. And so it's a good place to start our Sunday morning. As we come to our confession before the Lord, let us consider how our week has gone. Let's take a second to think about that. And then we will say together, Almighty God, long-suffering and of great goodness, I confess to you with my whole heart my neglect and forgetfulness of your commands, my wrongdoing, thinking and speaking, the hurts that I have left undone. O God, forgive me, for we have sinned against you, and raise us up to newness of life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Thank you, Lord, for hearing our confession and the thoughts of our hearts and minds. And thank you that you love us and you forgive us and you will bring us into fullness of life in Jesus' name. Amen.
Faithful one, so unchanging. This morning's reading is taken from Hebrews chapter 11. Faith in action. Now faith is confidence in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see. This is what the ancients were commended for. By faith, we understand that the universe was formed at God's command, so that what is seen was not made out of what was visible. By faith, Abel brought God a better offering than Cain did. By faith, he was commended as righteous when God spoke well of his offerings. And by faith, Abel still speaks, even though he is dead. By faith, Enoch was taken from this life, so that he did not experience death. He could not be found because God had taken him away. For before he was taken, he was commended as one who pleased God. And without faith, it is impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who earnestly seek him. By faith, Noah, when warned about things not yet seen, in holy fear built an ark to save his family. By his faith, he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness that is in keeping with faith. By faith, Abraham, when called to go to a place he would later receive as his inheritance, obeyed and went, even though he did not know where he was going. By faith, he made his home in the promised land, like a stranger in a foreign country. He lived in tents, as did Isaac and Jacob, who were heirs with him of the same promise. For he was looking forward to the city with foundations, whose architect and builder is God. And by faith, even Sarah, who was past childbearing age, was enabled to bear children, because she considered him faithful who had made the promise. And so from this one man, and he as good as dead, came descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky and as countless as the sand on the seashore. All these people were still living by faith when they died. They did not receive the things promised. They only saw them and welcomed them from a distance, admitting that they were foreigners and strangers on earth. People who say such things show that they are looking for a country of their own. If they had been thinking of the country they had left, they would have had opportunity to return. Instead, they were longing for a better country, a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared a city for them. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Good morning, or if you're watching a recording of this at some other point in the day, good afternoon, or even good evening. My name's Peter Scott. I am one of the readers at All Saints. I wish I had your faith. I wonder whether anyone said that to you at some point in the past. I was having a conversation with a woman the other day and happened to mention to her that my wife Jenny and I go to All Saints Church in Sidmouth, and our faith, our Christian faith, plays an important part in our lives. I wish I had your faith, was her response. We understand, don't we, that in the Christian life faith is important. In fact, I imagine we'll agree with the writer to the Hebrews, as it says in verse 6 of our reading today, that without faith, it is impossible to please God. But what do we mean by faith? Or more importantly, what does the Bible mean by faith? Hebrews chapter 11 will be the focus of our studies for the next few weeks. And it provides us with an overview of the lives of some of the great men and women of the Old Testament and how their faith in God shaped their lives. As we shall see, for them, faith meant taking God at his word and acting appropriately. As we look at their example, I hope that we will learn what it means for us to live by faith in the way that they did. But what is this faith that we're talking about? The opening verse of Hebrews 11 may appear at first glance to give us a definition. The writer says this: faith is confidence in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see. Faith is confidence about what we hope for. But I think rather than giving us a definition of faith, what this verse helps us to understand is the role that faith plays in our lives, and in particular the role that faith plays in relation to our hopes. In everyday speech, faith is trust. If I trust someone, if I have faith in someone, I trust them to do as they have promised. I trust my garage to mend my car. I trust the Royal Mail to deliver my parcel. I trust my friend to show up on time. Of course, my faith may be misplaced. I may trust my garage to fix my car, only to find that it still won't start. I may trust the Royal Mail to deliver my parcel, only to discover that it's got lost in the post. I may trust my friend to be on time, but he may end up being late or even not showing up at all. But in the Bible, when we speak of faith, we speak primarily of trust, not in people, but in God. Trust that he will do what he promises to do. And God always keeps his promises. In his commentary on Hebrews, Tom Wright says this: faith is looking at God and trusting him for everything. As we look at these Old Testament heroes of faith in the coming weeks, we'll see that faith produces a distinctive direction for the lives of those who are featured in this chapter. And that only makes sense if what they believed about God is true. For example, we can see the example of Noah, who built that huge boat in the middle of the desert, trusting, believing that what God had told him about the coming flood would actually take place. You can imagine all the comments from his neighbours and friends. But Hebrews 11:1 connects faith, this trusting God, with hope. Faith is confidence in what we hope for. In other words, faith in God gives us the assurance that things we hope for will come to pass. As with faith, we have everyday hopes. I hope it won't rain on Tuesday. I hope the bus will come on time. I hope my football team wins on Saturday. And of course, many of our hopes are mere wishful thinking. But again, the hopes the Bible talks about are of a different order. Hebrews 11 gives us examples of what kind of hopes the people of God in the Old Testament had. They include Abel's hope that God would receive his offering, Noah's hope that the ark he'd built would survive the deluge, Abraham's hope that God would give him a land and an heir, and Moses' hope that the angel of death would pass over the houses which had blood sprinkled on the doorposts. Now notice that all these hopes are based on implicit or explicit promises made by God to each of these individuals. And these hopes point forward to an even greater hope made by God through his Son Jesus. You see, in the New Testament, the greatest hope spoken of by Jesus and by his apostles is the hope that God will fully and finally forgive us our sins because of what Christ has done for us on the cross. And that one day Christ will come again to bring his righteous judgment on earth and to make all things new, to usher in his kingdom in all its completeness and finality and beauty. But how could these people be sure that these hopes would be realised, that their hopes were not based on wishful thinking? Well, this is where faith comes back in. Faith makes us confident that we will receive from God what we hope for. It is faith that gives substance to our hopes. Because of who God is and what he's done for his people in history and in Christ, we can be reassured that when the things we hope for align with the things he has promised, we most certainly will receive them. We see in the earlier chapters in Hebrews how this faith worked out in the lives of the early church. Hebrews is a letter written to Christians facing serious hardship and persecution. The letter reminds them of all that God has done for them in the sacrificial death of his son Jesus. And because of this, they could have a unique and living relationship with God, their Creator, which put their present sufferings into a different context. In the previous chapter, chapter 10, these two qualities of faith and hope are referenced by our writer. He writes this. He says, "Let us draw near to God with a sincere heart and with a full assurance that faith brings, the full assurance that faith brings." And then later in that chapter, "Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful." He who promised is faithful. Faith gives substance to our hopes. In this case, faith gives substance to our hope that as we draw near to God, God will welcome us into his presence through the blood of Jesus. Well, what could this mean for us today? Three things I want to suggest. First of all, we need to be sure that the foundational hopes on which we base our lives are things that God has promised for us. The Bible does not promise an easy life or permanent good health, or a large bank balance, or even good things like marriage or a fulfilling career. But if we have faith, what the Bible does promise us is forgiveness of sins and access to the very presence of God, our Creator, both in the present and for eternity. Secondly, we need to be sure that our faith is in the God who has revealed himself in the Bible, and what we know of his character and purposes. We do not put our faith in our own wisdom or the abilities of others, but we put our faith in God, the God who has supremely made himself known in Jesus. So we need to spend time reading and reflecting on the scriptures, the Bible, so that the scriptures will shape both our hopes and our faith, and the faith which gives assurance to our hopes. Finally, don't be surprised if your biblically shaped hopes and biblically informed faith take you to some unexpected places. For Noah, they took him into boat building. For Abraham, they took him on a long walk to the promised land. For Moses, they took him out of Egypt through the Red Sea and into the wilderness. I wonder where your hopes and your faith might take you. Amen.
Let us pray. Dear Lord, our Heavenly Father, We give thanks for the word brought to us this morning by Peter. Help each one of us to lead our lives by faith and to obey God in all he asks of us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We bring before you all the families who have not been able to feed their children adequately through this half term here in the UK. We give thanks for the food banks around the country who are dispensing more and more food to those in need. Lord, we ask that our government takes action and ensures that all these families are fed. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. People all around the world are suffering from the coronavirus. Some countries are dealing with it rather better than others. We think particularly of the refugees in Syria who not only have lost their homes and are living in makeshift camps, but the coronavirus is spreading freely through these camps. Lord, we beg you to help them, and we pray that the wealthier countries may help the poorer countries, and that this pandemic may be brought to an end. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We bring before you our town of Sidmouth. We at All Saints ask that you help us to shine your light throughout the town, into the schools, into the nurseries, into the care homes, and into the hospital. Family life is difficult at the moment, so we ask that you bring peace to those who are living in disharmony, and that together we can bring stability to the children in Sidmouth. We pray for all those who are unwell at this time, all those who are isolating, and all those who have lost a loved one. We ask for all these things in and through the name of Jesus. Amen. Let us say the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
blessing. Manna rained down from heaven. This isn't second guessing. We know that we are protected. May the peace that surpasses all understanding be our message. Grace and favors in your nature, in your essence.
May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations,
and your family, and your children,
and the children, and the children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children. May his favor be upon you.
So we come to our final prayer. I hope you've been blessed by the UK blessing song. I think it's one of the most amazing songs to have come out of this time that we've been through recently. So let's just pray to conclude our service today and to commit to God our week next week. Father, we thank you for what you have spoken to us today, Father. Thank you that you have blessed us and that, Lord, we can go into next week knowing that even in the difficult and unseen times, that you are there by our side to lead us and to guide us and to keep us safe in your name. We thank you for that and pray that you would bless each one of us in Jesus' name. Amen. Goodbye. Have a good week.
Lord, turn his face toward you.